Thank you all for joining me today. So, saying earlier, it is the perfect weather to talk about Macbeth, nice and stormy and gray. My name is Veronica Reynolds. I'm the head of community relations here at New City Library. And normally this would be when I introduce another speaker, but today I'm only introducing myself. The caveat is I am not a master expert on Shakespeare. I am a very enthusiastic amateur scholar of Shakespeare. I took many classes in undergrad. I minored in British literature. I have been fortunate enough to see several renditions of Macbeth in particular, and I did act in some Shakespeare at one point in my life as well. So it's an area where I have a lot of personal interest, and I have tried my best to be as accurate as possible in all things. We're also going to see several clips from performances. If you don't see your favorite, it's really what was widely available that I could get without a copyright violation. So you may not see some performances that you think are ideal, but I tried to choose some that I think are good representations of the characters and the times we'll be talking about. I am going to start with a historical overview, talk a little bit about the curse, and then we'll talk about the play itself. So foul and fair a day I have not seen. The background of the play. Macbeth was likely written in 1606 when James I sat on the throne of England, which he had inherited from Queen Elizabeth only 3 years prior. As a patron, Shakespeare would have sought to flatter the king and did insert one of his ancestors, Banquo, into the work. This was very similar how Shakespeare wrote for Elizabeth, often writing flatteringly of her relatives. If you were here for my Richard III talk, there was a similar theme there as well. The general themes of the play are regicide, murdering of a monarch, betrayal, and demonic influences, which were all greatly on James I's mind. You may be familiar with the gunpowder treason, which is what causes Guy Fawkes Day. It was aimed at James and had occurred just a year before the possible premiere of the play. If you're not familiar, the gunpowder treason involved setting up many barrels of gunpowder underneath the Parliament with the intent to blow it up in protest of many issues at the time. And James was also petrified of witches. He wrote a treatise on how one might discover a witch. So James I plays a big role in this play in that he influenced it substantially. He lived from 1566 to 1625. His mother was Mary, Queen of Scots, otherwise known as Bloody Mary. He was the King of Scotland starting in 1567. You'll notice that he was just not even 2 years old when he inherited that throne. There were three regents who helped him reign until he reached his majority, and he was king in Scotland until the day he died. But he also became King of England and Ireland in 1603 with the passing of Elizabeth, and again reigned until he died. So he was quite a powerful monarch. He had several areas of operation where he was able to thrive. But what he was really known for before he became the King of England was the witch hunts. Under his direction in Scotland, more than 4,000 people were executed for witchcraft. His obsession with witches is theorized was probably rooted in his mother's death. Mary was beheaded for crimes against her half-sister Elizabeth in England during a bitter struggle for royal and religious control of the country. This is a quote from Sir Harrington, who said, "His Highness told me her death was visible in Scotland before it did really happen, spoken of in secret by those by whose power of sight presented to them a bloody head dancing in the air." So he was afraid of witches from the beginning of his life to the very end. It would mark many, many decisions that he made. The Witchcraft Act in 1604 made hanging mandatory for the first offense of witchcraft, even if the person involved had not committed murder. So this was a big, big change. All you needed to do was be accused of witchcraft. And of course, it was very difficult to disprove that you were a witch. So many people, innocent people, were put to death. The same year that that act passed, we have Christopher Marlowe's play, The Tragic History of Life and Death of Dr. Faustus, which some of you were probably familiar with. It had been performed in 1588, 5 years before his death. And it was one of the most shocking portrayals of witchcraft ever to be performed at the time. So Shakespeare wasn't alone in maybe starting to cater to the interests of their patron monarch. One of James' big turning points in his witchcraft obsession was in 1589. He was betrothed to Anne of Denmark. She was supposed to sail out to Scotland to meet him, and she almost died in a very violent storm. He decided to sail back to Denmark and collect her in person, which was very unusual for him. That was not his usual mode. He wasn't a particularly chivalrous person. But on the return voyage, there were more storms and one of the ships was lost. So James, who was already convinced that witchcraft was everywhere, decided that supernatural forces were responsible. And as soon as he reached Scottish shores, he started racking up some of those 4,000 deaths I just mentioned. And Shakespeare himself wove several references of this voyage into Macbeth. So the line, "Though his bark cannot be lost, yet it shall be tempest tossed," seems almost certainly to be an allusion to that near-death experience in 1589. So short attention span theater. Macbeth is very short in its length, and it's rumored that this was due to James' lack of patience with longer works. It is the shortest of the tragedies at only 2,477 lines. The shortest play overall is Comedy of Errors, which is 1,700 lines. The longest is Hamlet, 4,000 lines. And the average Shakespeare play is read at about 1,000 lines. Oh, that can't be right. I think that means I meant to write 100 lines a minute. My apologies. Macbeth is one of the bloodiest plays. Arguably, Titus Andronicus is the bloodiest, or at least the goriest. Lear and Hamlet also have higher body counts. But I think Macbeth is often remembered as one of the darkest. So what was the truth behind the fiction of this play? Excuse me while I butcher this name, I'll do my best. Macbeth Macfindlaching, known in English as Macbeth, was born around 1000, the year 1005, and he was a very real Scottish king. In August 1040, he killed the ruling King Duncan I in a battle near Elgin, Morayshire, and became king himself. Now, do note here that he killed Duncan in battle. This wasn't a dark plot. They were fighting. For 14 years, Macbeth seems to have ruled pretty well. People liked him. He instated law and order. He was encouraging Christianity. And then in 1054, he was challenged by another nobleman, Siward, who was the Earl of Northumbria. And he was trying to put Duncan's son, Malcolm, who was also his nephew, on the throne. In August 1057, Macbeth was killed at the Battle of Lumphanan in Aberdeenshire by Malcolm Canmore, who did later become Malcolm III. All that to say, no witches here. While there is some political plotting and back and forth happening, everything is happening on the battlefield. There's no backdoor deaths. So while this is dealing with real truth of history, Shakespeare is certainly taking tremendous creative liberties to make sure that Macbeth looks like a no good neck. But I lured you all here with a promise of curses. So what about that curse? So if you've been around actors for any length of time, you'll know that it is considered a grave error to say Macbeth. If you're performing in it, one would call it the Scottish play. Legend has it that in its very first performance around 1606, it was riddled with disaster. Supposedly the actor, which would have been a young boy playing Lady Macbeth, died suddenly, so Shakespeare himself had to take on the part. Now, granted, we have no historical evidence of this. This is one of those things that gets passed around as truth without a ton of evidence. However, the other really big story is absolutely provably true. We know all of this happened. The Astor Place riot, which took place in New York City in 1849, absolutely killed people and caused a lot of injuries. And it was not at its heart, but peripherally, it was between these two actors. You had the American actor Edwin Forrest, English actor William Charles Macready. They were both playing in Macbeth at the same time. It was really more of a class riot. There was a lot of tension in New York City around classes at the time. And it wasn't unusual for people to use theater as a catalyst to riots. This had happened before, but they tore a theater apart. There were a lot of deaths and injuries. It was pretty ugly, and it did ostensibly happen because of Macbeth. I just had some fun collecting some of these other cursed stories that I thought I'd relay to you. Some of them are apocryphal, some of them are absolutely correct. We have the historical evidence of them, so I'll go over some of the early ones. It's hard to verify the earlier ones, so I've put that in that first category. It was said that in 1672, an actor who was playing Macbeth supposedly used a real dagger to kill the actor who was playing Duncan on stage. In 1721, during a performance, a nobleman in the audience got up in the middle of the scene and walked across the stage to talk with a friend. You thought cell phones were bad. People were behaving badly in theaters forever. Apparently the actors chased him off the premises and he was so mad that he came back with militiamen who burned the theater down. So that's a bad performance. In 1775, the actor playing Lady Macbeth narrowly escaped being assaulted by the audience. More recent and more verifiable examples of the curse. In the 1942 run of the play starring Sir John Gielgud, it had a very high body count. Three actors died in unexplained circumstances and the costume designer committed suicide on opening night. In a Thursday night performance in 1947, actor Harold Norman was stabbed during the final sword fight in Act 5 and died of his wounds. On Thursdays, his ghost is now said to haunt the Coliseum Theater in Oldham, where the fatal scene was played. Even the great Laurence Olivier can't escape the curse. When he took on the role of the Scottish king, a heavy weight mysteriously dropped from above the stage, narrowly missing the actor by inches. When Charlton Heston took the lead in 1953, he suffered a motorcycle crash during the rehearsals and his legs were left horrifically burned during a performance, and it emerged that his tights had been mysteriously soaked in kerosene. Arguably, some of these are less a curse and more that somebody was quite annoyed with the lead actor, but it does seem to all crash down. So is it true? Do you think that Macbeth is cursed? It's certainly possible. But non-believers in the curse hold that the tragedies, aspects of the play itself kind of make it accident prone. So the main issue is that there's often very dim lighting for Macbeth. It's unusual to see Macbeth done in very bright lights, although we'll see one example when we're looking at our clips. So I'll try and point that out. But you'll see a lot of our clips are even shot in the darkness, even though they're made for TV or the big screen. There's often smoke and fog generators. Even before fog machines, there might have been fires lit to billow smoke across a scene. And it also involves a lot of stage combat where people are using heavy and unwieldy broadswords. Now, granted, these should be props, but even a prop broadsword is quite a heavy thing to haul around, and it is possible to really injure people. But the most compelling thing that comes up often around Macbeth is that because it's very popular and also fairly short for Shakespeare, it's often kind of a last minute add-on to a theater stage season if a company isn't doing well. So the productions are under rehearsed, there's a lot of confusion around them, again, with smoke, darkness, stage combat, and the curse winds up getting blamed for an already failing company's subsequent closing because of incidents that occur. So I'll leave it up to you. If you prefer to call it the Scottish play, there's certainly no harm in that. So as interesting as that all is, let's get to the most interesting part, which is the play itself, because the play is the thing. Probably some of the more famous opening lines, even of Shakespeare's great opening lines, are the witches meeting each other. When shall we three meet again? In thunder, lightning, or in rain? So our play opens with Macbeth and his friend Banquo, who are returning from battle triumphant. And there they encounter the witches who make Macbeth three promises. So Roman Polanski did do a version of Macbeth. And I'm gonna go ahead and bring up his witches' prophecies.
Indeed, which outwardly you show. My noble partner, you greet with present grace and great prediction that he seems rapt withal. To me you speak not. If you can look into the seeds of time and say which grain will grow and which will not, speak then to me, who neither beg nor fear your favors nor your hate.
Lesser than Macbeth and greater.
Not so happy, yet much happier.
Thou shalt beget kings, though thou be none. So all hail Macbeth and Banquo.
Banquo and Macbeth, all hail you.
Stay, you imperfect speakers. Tell me more. By Sinel's death, I know I am thane of glass. But how of Cawdor? Say from whence you owe this strange intelligence. Or why upon this blasted heath you stop our way with such prophetic greeting. Whither are they vanished? Into the air.
And what seemed corporal melted as breath into the wind.
Were such things here as we do speak about? Or have we eaten of the insane root that takes the reason prisoner?
Children shall be kings.
You shall be king.
And thane of Cawdor too.
Went it not so?
To the self same tune and words.
The two actors are John Finch playing Macbeth and Martin Shaw as Banquo. Time. All right. So that's the prophecies of the witches, which you could hear better than I could since it's streaming right through Zoom, but I hope the sound was good for you. So when they greet Macbeth, they're greeting him as the Thane of Glamis, which was already his title, the Thane of Cawdor, and eventually King, which was not his title yet. They also tell Banquo that he will beget a line of kings, but never be a king. And you'll recall that this is James the first ancestor who was plugged in there to gain a little bit of favor. Conveniently, the current King Duncan is on his way. He has said that since Macbeth was so victorious in battle, that he's going to be the Thane of Cawdor, which was the title that the witches had already predicted. Slightly less conveniently, Duncan named his son Malcolm as heir to the throne. I do see the request for subtitles. I will do my best. Not every one of the videos that's up has them, unfortunately, but I will put them up to the best of my ability. Myrna, I'm seeing you have a question. If you can put it in the chat, go ahead. If not, I will unmute everybody at the end so we can ask any questions you want to ask out loud. All right. So then we meet Lady Macbeth, who's reading a letter her husband has sent her about the witch's prophecies. And for this one, we have the effervescent Miss Judy Dench. Let me see. And this one does have subtitles. So how's that? I don't know how great the subtitles will be. We're coming into this scene that Lady Macbeth has just received a letter, which she has read out loud for us, but I am skipping the letter. We're going to go right into what she has to say.
Yet do I fear thy nature. It is too full of the milk of human kindness to catch the nearest way. Thou wouldst be great, art not without ambition.
So what she's already starting to lay down here is that she doesn't think her husband has the chutzpah to take the throne that he's been promised.
Thou wouldst highly, that wouldst thou holily. Wouldst not play false, and yet wouldst wrongly win. Thou'dst have great glams, that which cries, thus thou must do if thou have it, and that which rather thou dost fear to do than wishest should be undone. Hie thee hither, that I may pour my spirit in thine ear, and chastise with the valor of my tongue all that impedes thee from the golden round which fate and metaphysical aid doth seem to have thee crowned withal. What is your tidings?
The king comes here tonight. All right.
So what we're already seeing here is that Lady Macbeth wishes that it was really her that had been given this prophecy, because she's afraid her husband can't really manage all of this, that he will somehow fall short of expectations. This is where we get a very famous and much debated line where she talks about the fact that she would dash her child to the ground from her nursing breast, essentially murdering her baby to get what she wants, to become queen. And it's caused a lot of conversation over whether or not the Macbeths are meant to have children, because we never see or hear of them, but she is talking as if she is a mother. There's a lot of debate and no answers on that subject, but something to think about as we move forward. Another extremely famous moment in Macbeth is the moment that Macbeth decides that he will kill Duncan. If you were with me for my Hamlet lecture, you'll know that Hamlet spent the entire play deciding whether or not to kill his uncle. Macbeth gets it done in the first act. He's not as indecisive, although he has to be persuaded first by his wife and then by a hallucination. And it's easy to interpret the play either as a harried man who's afraid of his wife or is cowed by her, or a power-hungry murderer in his own right. You could interpret it both ways, especially in this scene. And for this one, I do have Patrick Stewart for you. Several of the clips I'm showing are from the same edition. It was widely available, so I was able to use it. Unfortunately, this one does not have subtitles, but I do think Patrick Stewart's fairly good at enunciating the Shakespeare. So hopefully that helps.
Is this a dagger which I see before me?
You hear the shadowing?
The handle to how dark it is. Hand. Come, let me clutch thee. I have thee not, and yet I see thee still. Art thou not fatal vision, sensible to feeling as to sight? Or art thou but a dagger of the mind, a false creation proceeding from the heat-oppressed brain? I see thee yet. Thou marshalest me the way that I was going, and such an instrument I was to use.
Things I particularly like in this clip is that half of his face is in shadow, as if his warring nature, the darkness and the light,
mine eyes are made the fools of the other senses, or worth all the rest. I see thee still, and on thy blade and dudgeon gouts of blood was not so before.
Now, there are productions where there is physically a knife present in this scene.
There's no such thing.
I think it's more effective when there isn't, personally, but you can do it both ways.
Bloody business which informs thus to mine eyes.
And so when push comes to shove, Macbeth does the deed. The guards outside the room are rendered unconscious, and then he kills them, pretending to do so in a murderous rage at their incompetence the next morning. So he's able to justify their deaths. Homicide was a lot easier to get away with before DNA. Law and Order Scotland, medieval Scotland, has not gotten underground yet. Now, racked by fear or guilt or both, Macbeth turns to his wife, and she does the work of framing the two servants, claiming they'd gotten blackout drunk the night before. Duncan's sons flee the country, fearing that the murderer will come for them next. So the rightful heirs have left Scotland. This provides further cover for Macbeth, as this makes them look like potential suspects. Banquo alive, Banquo dead. Up to this point, Banquo has mostly been a benign accompanier to Macbeth. He also got a prophecy, remember, that his children would become king. We know that Banquo is, in all reality, James the First's ancestor, so the prophecy we know comes true. But Macbeth is done with letting prophecies come true unless they're for him. So he hires murderers to take out Banquo and his son Fleance. Banquo is killed, but Fleance escapes. At the night of there's a feast, and Banquo haunts Macbeth as a ghost. So the supernatural is starting to layer in. There's a tremendous amount of supernatural events in Macbeth compared to some of the other plays. Take Hamlet, for instance, where he does encounter his father's ghost, but he's not constantly encountering his ghost. And it is a singular incident in that there's not hundreds of ghosts appearing in Hamlet. This is another short scene. This one is from the Michael Fassbender and Marion Cotillard version. Quite short, but gives a good flavor, I think, to what was going on. Again, very dark.
What, my good lord?
Thou canst not say that I did it!
See, at this point, Macbeth has already been crowned king.
Well. Sit, worthy friends. Pray you keep seat. The fit is momentary. Upon a thought, he will again be well. If much you note him, you shall offend him and extend his passion. Feed and regard him not. Are you not?
Look on that which might appall the devil.
Oh, proper stuff.
Prithee, see there. Behold. Look, lo, how say you?
This is the very painting of your fear. This is the air-drawn dagger which you said led you to Duncan. Why do you make such faces?
So the question of being haunted by your guilt becomes pretty clear when we talk about Macbeth, both for Lady Macbeth and for Macbeth himself. They've committed these acts to maintain power, but the real question is, was it worth it? They're haunted either by very real ghosts or by their own minds, and they deteriorate throughout the show. There's a very interesting interlude that comes about in the middle of the play, because we do revisit the witches several times through the play. I think Shakespeare knew he was on to something, both because he wanted witches for his patron in the show, but also because the witches are really fun. They can say very strange things. They can be depicted in many ways. We'll see a later clip in that same Patrick Stewart version. They are nurses, nuns who are nurses. But I have seen versions where they're mad scientists, versions where they work at a carnival. You can have a lot of fun with the witches. So they appear several times. So in this witchy interlude, Hecate, who's a Celtic goddess, was often associated with witchcraft, and she appears before the witches. And she's angry because she was excluded from their talks by Macbeth. She plays an important role in the play, even though she has this one appearance, because the line she utters at the end of the scene: "And you all know security is mortal's chiefest enemy." She reveals in these lines that Macbeth's belief that he's untouchable will ultimately result in his downfall. "Pride goeth before destruction, and am haughty spirit before a fall," which is from Proverbs from the King James Bible. And yes, that King James. One thing to tie back to our historical interest is that James was also the first king to have a official English translation of the Bible. Previously to that, there had been vernacular English translations, but they were banned. They were considered illegal. They weren't very good translations. They were of questionable quality. So this was the first time that the Bible became widely accessible to English speakers. Previous to that, it had been mostly in Latin in these countries, and was pretty much therefore only accessible to highly educated people. So he did bring that into play, and certainly "pride goeth before the fall" is a big downfall of Macbeth himself. So I'm gonna go ahead and share Unfortunately, I really like this version of Hecate's speech, and I cannot find a good credit for this actress's name. So if anyone recognizes her, let me know, because she's delightful. She's a great Hecate. Again, you're going to see a single actor in darkness talking. This is very, very popular for Macbeth monologues. You see it a lot in Hamlet, in Richard III, some of the other tragedies as well. But Macbeth, something about Macbeth makes everyone want to turn the lights out.
Have I not reason, beldams, as you are, saucy and overbold? How did you dare to trade and traffic with Macbeth in riddles and affairs of death? And I, the mistress of your charms, the close contriver of all harms, was never called to bear my part or show the glory of our art. And which is worse, all you have done has been but for a wayward son, spiteful and wrathful, who, as others do, loves for his own ends, not for you. But make amends now, get you gone, and at the pit of Acheron meet me in the morning. Thither he will come to know his destiny. Your vessels and your spells provide your charms and everything beside. I am for the air. This night I'll spend unto a dismal and a fatal end. Great business must be wrought ere noon. Upon the corner of the moon there hangs a vaporous drop profound. I'll catch it ere it come to ground, and that, distilled by magic sleights, shall raise such artificial sprites as by the strength of their illusion shall draw him on to his confusion. He shall spurn fate, scorn death, and bear his hopes above wisdom, grace, and fear. And you all know security is mortal's chiefest enemy. Hark, I am called. My little spirit, see, sits in a foggy cloud and stays.
Fate's speech. I really love that presentation of it. Something to clarify, I use a lot of clips when I do Shakespeare for one very important reason, which is Shakespeare is theater. I started doing these lectures several years ago because someone said they wanted help reading Shakespeare. And reading Shakespeare is great. I'm really glad that anyone wants to sit and read a play. But there is so much life to seeing an actor present it that sometimes, even when the language is difficult, you can at least get the feeling from the performance. And I think it really enriches any understanding you're going to have of a show. Reading Shakespeare can be really delightful, the vocabulary, the hidden meanings, the double entendres, but seeing it sometimes conveys that better than anything else can. So then we get a spot of politics. Malcolm has fled to England, and there he has formed an agreement with the King of England in order to retake the throne of Scotland from Macbeth. From the beginning of the play, we do know of a man named Macduff. He has not yet appeared. He is also staying at Iverness the night of Duncan's murder. And when he does appear, he immediately doesn't believe Macbeth's story. And he doesn't go to his coronation, which would have been a big scandal. Once Macbeth understands that Macduff will not be loyal to him, Macduff becomes a particular focus of his guilt and anger and rabid desire to protect his power. Essentially, Macduff is the first doubter, and from that, Macbeth can never forgive him. So Macduff and Malcolm come to an agreement, and they become very powerful allies. And then we go back to the witches, because we love the witches. And this is where we get their most famous scene, our double toil and trouble. They tell Macbeth, who has gone to them to get more prophecy from them, and they show him several apparitions or ghosts or images. And they say that he can only be defeated when the great Birnam Woods march to Dunsane Hill and be bloody, bold, and resolute, laugh to scorn the power of man, for none of woman born shall harm Macbeth, which is quite a promise. No man of woman born can harm Macbeth. So he takes that to mean he doesn't have to worry about Macduff. But then again, why just take the witch's words for it? So he walks away and decides to kill Macduff's wife and children just to be extra. But we can't go and not show a clip from the witches. So I'm going to warn you, this one's mildly bloody. They use some disturbing imagery for this. So if that's not your thing, the clip is a minute and 47 seconds long. So this is a good time to go fill your glass of water, get another cup of coffee. It's not terribly disturbing, but it is a little more shocking than some of the other clips that we've watched.
Of my thumbs. Something wicked this way comes. Open locks. Whoever knocks.
I particularly like that clip mostly because it really gives you a taste of Shakespeare as musical, poetic in its own way. You can hear the rhythm, and it's done in a more modern way that might translate a little bit better. But that is the conversation that Macbeth walks into. This is when they show him his three apparitions, and he learns that he can't be killed. He can only be defeated when the Birnam Woods march on a hill, and he can't be killed by any woman born. So despite all those warnings, he still decides to kill Macduff's family. He's a delight. He's a delightful person. And we get bounced back to Lady Macbeth. Lady Macbeth is probably one of the most interesting women characters that Shakespeare has written. Because she starts off as super aggressive, super ruthless, will do anything, which is not something that women characters were often allowed to be. She's heartless. But as Macbeth starts to become more and more ruthless, they're roles seem to switch, and the guilt catches up with Lady Macbeth faster. Macbeth may even realize this, as he doesn't tell her beforehand that he's even going to kill Banquo and his son. And she starts to recognize the error of their actions, saying, "'Tis safer to be that which we destroy than by destruction dwell in doubtful joy." And at last we come to another extremely famous scene. May have noticed that this play is riddled with extremely famous scenes. Macbeth, despite being a very short play, has many striking set pieces. I think in some ways, because it is a shorter play, Shakespeare has to cram more oomph into the scenes that are shown. So they really are probably many of them in the top 20 most memorable scenes from Shakespeare. Certainly, even people who have very little interest in Shakespeare remember "out, out, damn spot." So this scene, to set it a little bit, her maid has seen her sleepwalking and washing her hands, or attempting to wash her hands in her sleep. And there's a doctor spying on them, and they're attempting to figure out why she's doing all this. This particular clip is Kate Fleetwood, who I had not heard of previously, which is an excellent job. I'm going to apologize again. This one does not have closed captionings. It is also very dark, because that's how playhouses like to roll. With Macbeth, but it was one of the better versions that I could find. I think it's a very nice example, so I'll let them take the wheel.
Damn spot out, I say.
One, two. Why then, 'tis time to do it.
Hey.
hell is murky. Fie, my lord, fie. A soldier and a feared. What needs we fear? Who knows it when none can call our power to account? Yet who would have thought the old man to have had so much blood in him?
Do you mark that?
The Thane of Fife had a wife. Where is she now? What will these hands ne'er be clean? No, no more of that, my lord. No more of that. You mar all with this starting.
Go to, go to. You have known what you should not.
She has spoke what she should not, I'm sure of that. Heaven knows what she has known. It is the smell of the blood still. All the perfumes of Arabia will not sweeten this little hand.
Oh, what a sigh is there. The heart is sorely charged.
Oh, I would not have such a heart in my bosom for the dignity of the whole body.
Well, well, well.
Pray God it be, sir.
This disease is beyond my practice. Yet I have known those which have walked in their sleep who have died holily in their beds.
Wash your hands. Put on your nightgown, look not so pale. I tell you yet again, Banquo's buried. He cannot come out on's grave.
Even so.
To bed. To bed, there's knocking at the gate. Come. 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 Give me your hand. What's done cannot be undone. Oh, to bed. To bed.
So her distress is pretty palpable during those moments. It's certainly a scene that many great actresses have had great success showing off their skills in. And you can see how at war she is with the guilt that is now pressing down on her. So bloody deeds have bloody consequences. In England, Macduff is informed by Ross that his castle is surprised, his wife and babes have been savagely slaughtered. So Macbeth's attempt to wipe out Macduff's family were successful. He only missed Macduff himself. When this news of his family's execution reaches him, Macduff is stricken with grief and vows revenge. Prince Malcolm, who's Duncan's son, you may remember, who is supposed to become king, has succeeded in raising an army in England, and Macduff joins him as he rides to battle in Scotland to challenge Macbeth's forces. Just on the eve of battle, Macbeth is told that his wife has committed suicide. So Macbeth has both lost hope and is still determined to fight, when we get the infamous line, "Sound and fury, signifying nothing." So for the last clip today, I promise it's the last one, I have Ian McKellen delivering one of Macbeth's final speeches.
Wherefore was that cry?
The Queen, my lord, is dead.
She should have died hereafter. There would have been a time for such a word. tomorrow. And tomorrow. And tomorrow creeps in this petty pace from day to the last syllable of recorded time. And all our yesterdays have lighted fools the way to dusty death. Out, out, brief candle. Life is but a walking shadow. A poor player that struts and frets his hour upon the stage. And then is heard no more. It is a tale told by an idiot, full of sound and fury, signifying nothing.
Doesn't get any more iconic than that. Tomorrow, tomorrow, and tomorrow. So why does Macbeth start to lose hope in this moment? Well, prophecies have loopholes. As we all know from anyone who's read a good fairy tale, there's always a way of getting around those little moments. So when Macduff's forces start to approach, in a moment of strategy, they cut down branches from the trees of the woods and advance upon the hill to disguise themselves, and thus the great Burnham Woods march to Dunsian Hill. So already Macbeth has taken a blow, but when he goes to battle, after that big speech about tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow, he meets Macduff on the field. And when Macbeth tells him that no man of woman born can kill him, Macduff informs him that he was ripped untimely from my mother's womb. So we find out, very importantly in this, that C-sections don't count. So C-sections were performed starting in the 15th century. So this is something that would have been heard of at the time, but there was extremely high fatality rates until the late 19th century when we learned how to do it well. Mother and baby had a very low survival chance. If you didn't know, C-section means cesarean section, and it was because it was rumored that Caesar himself was born that way. So this was something that Shakespeare would have definitely have known about. It would have been a very bloody thing to mention in the beginning, at the end of a play. And it does put the end and the kibosh on. But Macbeth to the end does not surrender. Instead, Macduff violently beheads him on the battlefield, removes the crown and puts it on Malcolm's head. That's the reason I don't have a clip for this one. They're all beheadings, and I think we can all be spared that this afternoon. It's mentioned again that Lady Macbeth is dead to put the final note on the coffin. And like I said, we never hear of any Macbeth children. We're led to believe there are none, or they certainly would have come up at this point. So Malcolm is king, good has won, and all can celebrate. James I, who is actually a descendant of Banquo, not Malcolm, as we said a couple times, who did not succeed Macbeth in kinship. So though it's not mentioned in this scene, all of the witch's prophecies do come true, including that Banquo's descendants sit on the throne. So this is the big question. What does it all mean? Shakespeare probably had several intentions with this play. He was good at multiple meanings. Certainly, first and foremost, it was meant to entertain people. It was short, it was bloody, it had a lot of supernatural elements. It could have been a show on the CW. It would have done quite well. A lot of political play. Shows like this have remained popular throughout time. We love this stuff. But he may also have been looking to remind England about the costs of betraying the crown. Macbeth's big sin is killing Duncan. And the gunpowder treason had occurred only a year before its publication. So betrayal and uprising were certainly fresh in people's minds. It has a lot to say about how women were viewed at the time, and modern interpretations go in a lot of directions because of that. Do you believe that Lady Macbeth was simply an evil woman who was too frail to withstand the guilt of her own actions? Or is she conniving and interesting and a moral person who was tempted and suffers a cruel fate? Witchcraft then, and perhaps even now, is fascinating to our audiences. Back then, they hated witches and wanted to know more about them simultaneously, both to fight them and because things that we understand are less frightening. And now we find them entertaining and pleasing, and we dress of them as Halloween. So I don't know what that all means, but except that history is funny. And that destiny is a fickle thing, and blood will be met with blood. I think it's also an interesting question about prophecy itself. Are prophecies good? Even if they are honest and true, do we want to know our future? So with that being said, we have plenty of time for questions or curses. I would prefer questions.